We welcome to the program the international investigative author, Edwin Black, who will be visiting Broome County next week with a series of presentations. Mr. Black, welcome to our program.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to talk to you.
You are familiar with our area, Binghamton and Endicott, all part of what we call the Triple Cities. In fact, one of the topics that you'll be discussing next week involves IBM. Endicott, always regarded as the birthplace of IBM, but there is an aspect of IBM's history that many people in our area really don't like to think about, don't like to talk about, but that is one of the things that you'll be discussing on Monday, and some of our listeners are familiar with this. Some of our listeners may not even be aware of this. Tell us a bit about one chapter of IBM's history that people around here and certainly the company would like to forget.
Well, what they want to forget is what they cannot forget is that Thomas J. Watson directly and through his overseas subsidiaries, the president of IBM, personally micromanaged a strategic alliance with the Third Reich to co-plan and co-organize all six phases of the Holocaust. I mean, the identification of the Jews was the first. The second was their exclusion from society, all by tabulation methods. Third was the confiscation of their bank accounts, which were controlled and organized by IBM. Fourth was the ghettoization. Fifth was the deportation, since IBM ran all the trains in Europe. And sixth, even the extermination. Indeed, the Auschwitz tattoo that is so iconic began as an IBM prisoner number and then was overtaken by other numbering systems. Thomas J. Watson did this personally. He micromanaged it. And as I understand, there's a movement in Binghamton among students, alumni, faculty, social activists, community groups that want to address why the name of an unindicted war criminal, Thomas J. Watson, has adorned an important institution like your School of Engineering. That's up to them. But I'm coming on Monday at 7 o'clock, Lecture Hall 10, to at the school, at the invitation of these groups, to lay out the documentation for why and how Thomas J. Watson personally and knowingly helped co-plan and co-organized the Holocaust, by the way, for which he was honored by Adolf Hitler personally with a special Reich Medal for service to the Nazi regime, the Eagle with Cross.
And you wrote a book about this many years ago, and indeed many people around here have probably read the book or certainly heard of it, how Thomas J. Watson and IBM co-planned and organized the Holocaust. I mean, that's the name of your talk, but the book that you did, IBM and the Holocaust, received a lot of attention, not just in the United States, but globally.
Yes, of course. The original book in 2001 was IBM and the Holocaust, which at that time came out simultaneously in 40 nations in many languages, has now sold over 1.4 million copies. It is now in 200 countries and probably, I can't keep track of all the languages. Even this year alone, the newest edition has come out in Turkish, Portuguese, Czech, and Chinese. And what's interesting is one of my first stops in 2001, that's 16 years ago, 15 to 16 years ago, was Binghamton. We brought out the initial information that we had. I actually appeared in the Endicott Visitors Center at the invitation of local concerned groups. But since that time, we have found additional documents. We have made them available. So it'll be possible for everyone to come into Lecture Hall 10 and make their own judgment, see for themselves what Thomas Watson did, what Thomas Watson knew, and why he did it. From the very first greatest moments of the birth of the Reich in Berlin in 1933 to the last gasp of the Hitler regime in the first days of May, Thomas J. Watson was consciously doing business with the Third Reich, not just selling them equipment, but selling them solutions, because IBM even then billed itself as the solutions company, and they were even willing to give Adolf Hitler the final solution.
And I have watched the video of your presentation at the Endicott Visitor Center from September 2009. It's posted on YouTube, and it is remarkable, and you acknowledge to be in a position essentially steps away from what we natives here, Endicott and Broome County natives, have always been proud of, the history generally of IBM as the birthplace before the company even became known as IBM. And you mentioned during your presentation at the Endicott Visitor Center, if you're going to accuse IBM of mass murder in Endicott, you had to come prepared with documentation.
And that is still the case, but the documentation is deeper. I'm sure that you have seen some of the documents that I held in my hand. Now it will be possible to project these documents and other interviews with former IBM Nazi employees who have now revealed what occurred. It is possible for this to be projected on the big screen. This will be projected on the big screen. And despite thousands of interviews, thousands of requests, hundreds, probably thousands of film documentaries and film and TV reports, such as the ones I'm doing even this week, IBM has never denied a single comma of any information in my book. They've only said, we don't have the information. So the information company just says, we don't have any information on what we did. And then they've actually tried to spin a false narrative saying, well, we lost control of our company when the Nazis took over. That's completely incorrect. They've actually facilitated false histories of Watson. We must remember that Thomas J. Watson was a convicted extortionist before he ever was hired by IBM. He was convicted in the infamous National Cash Register extortion scheme, where they tried to stop people from selling used cash registers. And he was called as bad as what the judge said, that he was as bad as a Mexican bandit. Nowadays, we wouldn't use such terminology. But it's important to understand that Thomas J. Watson was a sociopathic war criminal.
You're saying this, by the way, on a Binghamton radio station, and I can just imagine what some of our listeners are thinking to hear that kind of strong language, especially if they were not familiar with this part of IBM's history. Now, one thing that I also want to touch on, and there we have limited time, but I do want to touch on this, is a name that most people around here aren't familiar with, and yet I just went by on my way into work. There's a little street in Endwell, just a mile or two west of the old IBM sprawling manufacturing complex from North Street in Endicott. There's a little street called Hollerith Avenue. And Hollerith punch cards were a key factor in what you're talking about. And here it is. There's a street, just a little dead-end street with about 13 or 15 houses in Endwell. It still honors the memory of Hollerith. Tell us who he was and what these punch cards were used for.
Well, that is fascinating. And I'm sure that once I come up to Binghamton and drive down Watson Boulevard, I could make a turn onto Hollerith Street. So
absolutely. It's just two, a block and a half north of Watson Boulevard in Endwell. It's two blocks from where I used to live.
Can you imagine being at the corner of Watson and Hollerith?
You know, I used to ride my bike on Hollerith Avenue, and as a little kid, I had no idea who Hollerith was. It's one street.
Let's tell the listeners.
Yeah, it's one street west of Bundy.
And Bundy was another name that was active in the day. So let me just say that all of this occurred before the age of computers, because before the age of computers, when we first entered the information age, it wasn't in Silicon Valley. It began in Berlin in 1933 with the individualization of statistics, all done by something that most of the college students at Binghamton do not know what it is, but all the older people do, and that is punch cards. And punch cards, to a large degree, acted like a music box. They stored information in the holes that were punched in columns and rows. Then that could be put through a reader, and then it could reveal something that had never been known before, information. It was developed for the Census Bureau as a people tracker, and IBM stole the technology from the Census Bureau. They used it for themselves. They sold it to the despotic regimes of Europe, and then they used it as a people tracker for the greatest despotic regime of all time, which is the Third Reich. So it was all done with punch cards. It took a massive investigation. You must remember, Bob, I was in Endicott 15 years ago with the video that you saw, and IBM has never said a word. IBM has never contradicted. How is it that you could come to Binghamton in 2001, as I did, and you could declare that this major corporation actively committed genocide under the personal micromanagement of Thomas J. Watson, and have that repeated throughout the world, every day, every hour, and still IBM remains silent?
We're speaking with the investigative author Edwin Black, who will be coming to Broome County next week with a series of presentations about this topic and a number of other important issues. One question that may be on the minds of our listeners this morning as they hear you speak about this aspect of IBM's history: were people here in Broome County, people in Endicott, actually complicit in what was going on?
Yes, of course. They were complicit. But I'm sorry to use this term, they were just following orders. They were actually told, if you don't agree with the countries that we are working with, find something that you can agree with and ignore what you can't agree with. This was a system-wide approach. The punch cards, each one of which could only be used a single time, like a bullet, were printed. And the machines were made, and they were repaired, and the spare parts were done on a global basis. They were shipped in from Vichy, France, through Portugal, the Netherlands, all sorts of collaboration between Nazi IBM officials and American IBM officials, enough to trigger an FBI investigation into whether Watson was actually smuggling in Nazis, and of course that investigation was ultimately terminated for lack of evidence. So yes, there were people throughout the United States who were complicit. These people are not with us now, and we should not judge anyone at IBM today by what was done by the company. But I will say this: of the five major corporations that I have identified as being absolutely pivotal to the success and scope of the Holocaust, that means General Motors, which made the Blitz trucks and the Ju-88 bombers secretly through Opel; the Ford Motor Company, which inspired Adolf Hitler and distributed his information, the Protocols of the Elders of Zion; the Carnegie Institution and the Rockefeller Foundation, which created the concept of the master race, a great deal of which was done right there in New York State, that created the idea of eugenics, that helped commit genocide against some 60,000 Americans by sterilizing bloodlines and imprisoning them in so-called psychiatric and other welfare farms and institutions. The one company of the five that is not apologized, that has not acknowledged its crime, that one company is IBM.
Do you believe Thomas J. Watson then was a war criminal?
Of course he was a war criminal, but he was a sociopathic war criminal. A sociopath is a guy who cannot, if you're colorblind, you cannot detect green from red. And if you're a sociopath, you cannot differentiate between good and bad. And Thomas J. Watson could not differentiate between good and bad. Business was the company's middle name. And Thomas J. Watson, under every definition of genocide, was, of course, an accomplice in genocide, specifically under the statute. I will bring that out. He was unindicted, but there were many war criminals who were unindicted. You remember the war criminals were businessmen. They were doctors. They were editors. They were diplomats. All those who helped this killing machine take place. And what Watson did and personally supervised, and for which he got a personal fortune, was not only a mass murder of the Jews, but also the persecution of the gypsies, the persecution of the homosexuals, the persecution of individuals who were of a socialist belief, especially in Spain. This was all done by IBM as part of the Third Reich, because their strategy was, if Germany wins the war, we will be their chosen data processor. And if America wins the war, we will have the ability to retain our status with them. The information that I'm going to bring out in black and white will be undeniable. It has never been denied, but it will have never been brought out more forcefully than it shall be done Monday at 7 o'clock in Lecture Hall 10. And we're even going to bring in alumni in other parts of the United States who have tried for years to get the university to address this. And it, years before I even knew about this movement, and they will tell what their experience is. And I should say, I'm there for five events. My second event, sponsored by Sociology Department, is on eugenics and how America sterilized some 60,000 Americans, created the concept of the master race, and then through the Carnegie Institution, Rockefeller Foundation, transplanted it into Nazi Germany knowingly. Third lecture will be on black victims of Nazi policy, how the first genocide of the 20th century was not the Armenians. The horrible nightmare of the Armenians, as most of us think. It was actually the Hereros in 1906 in German Southwest Africa. And that terrible murder then led to a group of people who returned to Germany to become the Nazis. And even Nazi thought continued in the United States in modern eugenics long after the war. My fourth event is on Israel and international law and the historical underpinnings. This talks about Israel at age 70, and of course, I'm all over the country on this. I just did this last night at SMU Human Rights Center in Dallas, where I am now. And my fifth event will be at SUNY Broome, where I talk about journalism in the misinformation age. This is a broad human rights visit, but my pivot, my anchor, is going to be addressing the war crimes that IBM committed under the direct micromanagement of Thomas J. Watson. Never been denied, cannot be denied.
Do you think that ultimately then there will be a time when the administrators and everybody, not everybody, but enough people at Binghamton University take heed of what you've just talked about, and certainly you'll talk about it at greater length with more detail on Monday. Do you think ultimately then that we will see the Thomas Watson School, the name of Mr. Watson, finally removed from the School of Engineering on the Vestal campus?
Well, that is a matter for the Binghamton University Council, the trustees, the students, the faculty, the community to discuss. My purpose is to come and give them the facts, which will help them formulate a proper understanding of what the issue is. You know, we are living in, I'm going to overgeneralize, a kind of a Me Too era where people are calling out the racists of our past and saying, you don't deserve a statue. This is why the Confederacy statues are coming down. Now, many people have said to me, do you approve of Confederacy statues coming down? Why don't you ask me if I would like to see monuments to the SS and the Gestapo up in modern Germany? The Confederacy stood for one thing. It stood for slavery. And we cannot have the artifacts of slavery and of African American torture and enslavement be enshrined as a monument of dignity and respect in our society. Now, it's not just limited to the Confederacy. There are scientists who have committed horrible atrocities, and they have a clinics and labs named after him. Of course, one of our space centers was named after the Nazi missile guru who helped run the slave mines in Pandemonde outside of Buchenwald. There are many areas in which we're finally understanding that these great symbols of dignity and respect that we're all supposed to look up to are in fact war criminals, people who have functioned to make a system less good, people who have committed crimes against humanity. And this includes the Confederacy. This includes people who were once in Hollywood and made some of our finest films, but along the way thought to victimize so many women. And now we have to understand that this kind of accountability does not stop at Broome County.
Edwin Black, the international investigative author, joining us this morning live from Dallas, Texas, and scheduled to give a series of 5 presentations in Broome County next week, including on the Binghamton University campus in Vestal and also at SUNY Broome in the town of Dickinson. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. The further details of my visit can be found on edwinblack.com.